ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us this edition of Leak Project. I am your host, Rex Bear, and tonight's guest is Diane Powell, MD, author, public speaker, researcher, and practicing psychiatrist. She has spoken in venues that vary from international scientific conferences to news and talk shows. Her education has been both broad and deep. She feels honored to have trained and worked with some of the best minds of the century and is fascinated with the concepts of biophysics and neuroscience. Author of ESP Enigma, Beyond Forgiveness, and Seriously Strange. Her most recent work, ESP Enigma, is featured as a revolutionary scientific explanation of psychic phenomena and the nature of human consciousness. It's a pleasure to have you on the show with us, Diane. If you would please tell our listeners a little bit about yourself and why you started to research the ESP Enigma.
Well, my background actually before becoming a doctor was I was doing neuroscience research, and I discovered that I really didn't like doing research on animals, and that the questions I was really the most intrigued by were questions that had to do with human consciousness and how our brain works and why we have the experiences that we do and why people behave the way that they do. And so with that interest in neurophysiology and in people and wanting to be able to do research, it really made more sense for me to go to medical school. And so I went to medical school at Johns Hopkins and was originally going to become a neurosurgeon, and I found psychiatry just much more interesting. It really was, to me, it was really the frontier of where a lot of the mysteries are. There's so many unsolved questions within this field. And so I just saw it as very exciting to go from being a neuroscientist to being a psychiatrist at the time that I did. And I spent, because of that, I have this background in which I think about the brain, and I have this knowledge about how it's what the theory is and what the model is for how the brain works. And then people, for me, are an opportunity to sit down with someone and to actually, in the process of discussing things with them or observing how they behave, it's actually kind of like neuroscience in application. And what I found was that there were things that people could do that really defied what neuroscience was telling us would be possible based on the model. So, for example, I learned about autistic savants because I'm a neuropsychiatrist, and I studied with Sir Michael Rutter in England at the Institute of Psychiatry. He's an expert on autism. He was knighted for his work on autism, and I was with him in the late 80s when autism was a really rare condition. And so I knew a lot about autism, and I had heard about savant syndrome way back then. And that's, for people who don't know about that, that's people like Rain Man. Although Rain Man, he had savant syndrome, he really didn't have autism. But anyway, this ability to have this phenomenal memory and to know things that doesn't make sense for how they might know it. So, for example, Kim Peek, he actually was born with hydrocephalus. The left hemisphere and the right hemisphere of his brain aren't connected with one another. And so he had this ability to read two books simultaneously, one with each eye, and retain all of that information. And yet his brain was more disconnected, has this big hole in the center, more disconnected than other people's brains, and yet he had this super memory. And that really goes against this idea of memory being based on this sort of networks and all of the connections and more intricate connections between neurons. It really makes you question that when you see people who have damage to their brain and it doesn't fit in areas where you're thinking, well, you know, that they really shouldn't be able to do that. And so I was more open, having understood the brain, more open than most psychiatrists would be to phenomena that stands out like a, you know, to me, like a shiny penny on a beach, that, you know, that, oh, this is, you know, this is different, you know, let me pick this up and look at it. And so when I was at Harvard, I was the psychiatrist who worked with medical students and with people in training to do consultations on medical and surgical floors and OB floors at Cambridge Hospital, which is a general hospital right there at Harvard Square. And while I was there, I had this woman who had been admitted for a possible heart attack the night before, and at a time when it took at least 24 hours to know whether or not somebody had had a heart attack. And she was telling the staff there that she was psychic and she was seeing ghosts and she wanted to go home. And I was called in to see her because you can't sign out of a hospital against medical advice if people think that you're suffering from a condition that is a mental illness. And when I went in to see her, she started telling me very specific things about, she told me some things about herself. Then she quickly, within about 10 minutes, started telling me very specific things about myself that she couldn't possibly know, and things about the future that actually ended up coming true. And so I started to, I always had that in the back of my mind. And in years of continuing to be a neuroscientist and trying to understand more and more about how the brain does what it does and how that relates to our conscious experience, I realized that the savant syndrome is really one of those mysteries that has to be understood. And the more so I returned back to studying the savant syndrome about 15 years ago. And when I did, the more that I looked at it, the more I realized that it resembled what people call ESP in many ways. And one of the ways in which it resembled ESP is that people who have savant syndrome frequently have this information that they can't tell you where it comes from. They weren't taught it. They don't have the analytical abilities to derive the information, and yet they have it. You know, things like the twins that Oliver Sacks knew, who couldn't do very simple tasks, they couldn't do simple mathematics, but they could spit out 12-digit and more prime numbers at a time when our computers had to churn really hard to even come up with that kind of data, and there's no real good algorithm for it. Even these autistic twins actually exceeded the computer capacity at the time. And so when you look at that and their description of that, the numbers just appeared in their heads, and then you talk with people who claim that they have psychic abilities, and they tell you they just see it in their mind's eye, or sometimes they experience it in external space. The answer for whatever it is they're looking for, and it's not derived, it's more perceptual. I find that really interesting. And so I see these autistic savants as perhaps a kind of like the Rosetta Stone, if you will, for kind of breaking the code and kind of unraveling some of these mysteries about consciousness and what we're really capable of doing as human beings.
Well, it's remarkable because I remember watching the film Rain Man, and he was so good. You know, Dustin Hoffman portrayed that character so well, this genius savant that could remember everything to a T, an absolute perfect photographic memory. Yet when it came to certain things like, okay, what's the difference between the price of a candy bar and a sports car? You know, the brain couldn't compute that. So it's very remarkable. We had Baffert on here the other day, and we were talking before the show about synchronicities. It was neat to get his take on savants and autism because you brought up earlier back in the 80s, there weren't nearly as many people that had autism, right? And now we're in a society where it seems like that's the regular normal thing. Asperger's, autism, some type of neurological disorder, a problem with the brain. And let me ask you, what do you feel has been the cause of this epidemic over the past 30 years?
Well, that's something that I actually have looked into because I've spent time with the families of people who have children diagnosed with autism in the course of my research, and I just see how the numbers have gone from what was 1 in 10,000 children back in the 70s and 80s to what's now thought to be 1 in 50 children. Some people say 1 in 45, and so
Right.
it's really global. It's not just the U.S. that is having this happen. And what I've seen is a medical, because I am a medical doctor, in looking at these children, what I see is that they are, first of all, there's no singular pathology to autism. So, in other words, if you were to be able to put all of these children in some kind of imaging technology, an MRI, which, I mean, a lot of them, they wouldn't stay still for it. You'd have to drug them, and it wouldn't really be a humane thing to do. But if you were to look at their brains, what you'd see is that their brains vary from child to child. There really is no single brain pathology that is associated with autism. Some of these children have problems with their cerebellum. Some of these children have problems with their temporal lobes. So you see these areas of major connection and areas of major disconnection. And so what is the common, if you were to say, what is the overriding commonality that these children have, is that something, and this is the consensus within medicine, scientific medicine right now, is that something's going wrong with what's called the pruning process. And so when children are developing their brains in the womb, and then also when they first enter into the world in the first, particularly the first 4 years of life, they have more brain cells, more connections, than they will ever use or need. And in fact, it's almost like a redundancy in the wiring, and if you don't get rid of some of it, it'll actually interfere with the learning process. And so what happens is that the brain undergoes this sculpting, just like if you had a sculptor who had a block of wood or whatever, that the learning process that these children undergo is one in which there's a feedback loop between the environment and the brain that's then shaping what that brain's connections are. And so these children who get diagnosed with autism, there's something that goes wrong in that process of determining which connections remain, which connections disappear. And there's several different causes. There's over 108 genes that have been identified. A lot of these genes relate to the recognition of what is self, what is diseased versus what's healthy, and you know, so self versus non-self versus what's healthy or diseased. It's basically our immune system. This is what's really become new in the several years, is learning the degree to which our immune cell system plays a vital role in determining which sections of the brain get carved away and which ones get reinforced. And what we know now is that the immune systems of these children are being way overchallenged by this increasingly artificial world that they're living in, with all of the things that they're exposed to, the lack of really nutritious food to support the immune system properly. We have a lot of electromagnetic radiation that we don't know, you know, what the long-term consequences of this is on, you know, the development of the brain or on even the evolution of the human species. I mean, what we've done to our planet is really just a huge we're finding out now, you know, in a sad way, we're finding out now what the consequences are. And I think that the brain is such an exquisite organ that it's well protected for a reason, because it doesn't take a lot to cause things to go awry in it, and in the development, particularly during the first 4 years.
Now, a lot of people, let me jump in here if I may for a second, Diane. There's been a lot of research on the connection of autism and neurological disorders from certain compounds that are put in many of the vaccines. And I'm not anti-vaccine. What I am is anti thimerosal, squalene, experimental adjuvants, and force-feeding babies with multiple rounds of vaccines at birth. Because if you look at the connections, and from what I've done research on, for example, I'm sure you heard of the gentleman that researched about 50,000 people that were Amish in the Amish community, and he was only able to find 3 cases of autism, and he knew for sure that 2 of them were vaccinated. And none of the other Amish were vaccinated that he had done the research on. So, I mean, there's certainly, in my opinion, got to be a connection there. So you look at these connections, and now it's 1 in 45, 1 in 55. It used to be 1 in 10,000. There weren't nearly the amount of vaccines back then. And sure, there's got to be other factors as well, like the stuff that's in the atmosphere, the industrial pollutants, the genetically modified foods, the chemicals they put in the corn, etc. Do you think that all of this vaccine or all of these chemicals in the vaccines caused brain damage and different parts of issues with many of the problems we see today?
Let me put it this way. because, you know, this is really such a hot potato. Recently in the news, their movie about Andrew Wakefield, and but you know, directed by Andrew Wakefield, about the whole vaccination question, was going to be in the Tribeca Film Festival, and Robert De Niro has a son with autism, and he worked at getting that in the festival. And then there was such a huge outcry by people saying, "Oh, these vaccines are safe, and how you're going to discredit the entire film festival by having this film." And it was really so. He within a day and a half, he had to pull it, and so it's not going to be in the film festival. And there's these people who are. It's such a topic that. What concerns me is the way in which, I mean, Robert De Niro was just saying we want to have a conversation about this, and I see how the topic is treated in a way in which it's like treated such that it's like no conversation can happen in the public eye because it's squashed. And so I started looking at why is there so much hostility. Why is there when really, I mean, I think that we as doctors have a duty to constantly be asking ourselves, you know, what, you know, reassessing what we're doing, you know, in terms of our treatments, and not just assuming, you know, making assumptions. And particularly when it comes to vaccines, one of the things that I found that I thought was very eye-opening was that back in 1986, President Reagan was aware of the fact that a lot of pharmaceutical companies weren't making vaccines, and there was a lot of scare about various flus and things. People have been worried about pandemics for a long time, and wanting to get people, you know, vaccinated, but the process by which they make vaccines, you know, is pretty compared to the rest of where medicine is at is, you know, is pretty barbaric still to this day. And so it was one of those things where they wanted to make it profitable, and because that's the only way pharmaceutical companies would touch it. And so what happened was is that President Reagan passed this legislature in 86 that removed them from having to do the necessary safety testing that is can be, like, when you think about trying to get a drug clinically approved by the FDA, it can be years and years and years of clinical trials to prove that it's safe. And so they removed the necessity for safety testing. And then what they did was is they also removed the liability from any consequences of any adverse effects from the pharmaceutical companies being responsible for it. And they put that into a tax that then the consumer getting the vaccine pays for. And then that tax goes to a vaccine injury court. And so what we have happening here is that there are a lot of children that are being injured by vaccines. The parents are reporting that their child was normal. There's video evidence their child was normal. And then they, afterwards, they get a after a vaccine, they have a, you know, a fever, and they're not normal afterwards. And it's known that vaccines can cause what's technically called encephalopathy, which means that because our brain has inside the brain, they're actually an integral part of the brain. There are as many immune cells in our brain as there are, and they, I mean, the thing that the neurons, the ones that, you know, have, generate the electrical magnetic potentials that people, you know, pay so much attention to. So when you consider we've got all these immune cells in our brain, and they discovered that if you activate the immune system in the periphery, the chemical messengers, the cytokines, they can travel into the, they can cross the blood-brain barrier, and they can activate the brain cells. They can activate the cells in the brain that are the immune cells. And so there actually is a theoretical reason why vaccines can cause something to go wrong in this whole pruning process. And so what's happening here is that I think that there's, on the one hand, you have the a combination of pharmaceutical companies that there's a lot of conflict of interest in terms of these vaccines, because it's a win-win situation for them, because they don't have any liability, and they and the profitability of these things is very high for them now, and they can even be mandated, and they have been mandated. The vaccine schedule has been increased dramatically over the course of my career, such that children by the age of two in a lot of states are mandated to have over 40 vaccines. And that's unheard of. I mean, when children who are now in their 20s were getting vaccinated, people of that generation, the ones who are now the mothers of this generation of autistic children, those vaccinations just had to occur before the person was, like, in, you know, grade school, it was less aggressive. We weren't vaccinating newborns back then. We weren't vaccinating pregnant women back then. So there's been this massive increase in vaccines, and yet we are not allowed to publicly discuss their safety. To do so as a doctor endangers your credibility, not, and your career. And so I find that very disturbing, whether the vaccines cause it or not. I find that climate of discourse very disturbing.
Yeah, it's really pretty sad. Now, one of the things also that you talk a lot about is the difference between the brain and the mind and consciousness. And I was hoping we could get into that a little bit too. That's fascinating.
Yes, sure. So what would you like to know?
Well, obviously your book, The ESP Enigma, let's talk about extrasensory perception. I've always been fascinated with the ability. I've had some really strange things happen to me that is for a whole other show, but would definitely say that I believe in the ESP ability. So have you had personal encounters where you've been able to, like, tap into somebody's mind and hear them like they were talking, but they were actually just thinking it? Or how did you really get into ESP, besides the one experience you had where the person basically told you about your life before it happened? Or have you had personal experiences yourself?
I have had personal experiences myself, and I really don't think, let me just say from the get-go, that I think that the ability to connect with another person when you have an intimate relationship, and the relationship you develop when you're someone's psychotherapist and you see them weekly on for over a decade, and they've told you their most intimate information, and you've shared with them their biggest heartaches and their and you're just emotionally, you're the one who's safe for them to be with, and you're the only one who's safe for them to be with. Those patients, it's fascinating, because that's very similar to the circumstance of these autistic children, which is just one of many reasons why I've been studying them to see if they have telepathy. But that intimate experience is one in which you actually sometimes experience this knowing information that you're just like, how could I possibly know this? And so in the beginning, I would know things about patients, and patients would know things about me, but I just really thought that it was because we had this long therapeutic relationship, and kind of like how a lot of, you know, couples get to know one another and can read one another's mind, but is that really telepathy? And but then what happened was that I had another uncanny experience with a patient of mine, and it was someone who was on the autistic spectrum, and I had been her therapist for a decade, and I was considering moving away from San Diego. I had practice in San Diego for over 10 years, and I had never thought about leaving Southern California. I was really actually reasonably happy there, and but I had this discussion this evening with some friends that I got together with. We met at the beach, and we ended up having this discussion in which it came up about the possibility of moving away and going to Oregon. And it really surprised all of us that we were having that conversation, because we were all people who were really pretty happy where we were living. But what happened was, is as we were walking back to the car, and there were five people, there were five of us, so there were four witnesses to this. We were walking back to the car. My phone rang, my cell phone rang, and it's rare for a patient to call me off hours on my cell phone. And it was a patient of mine, this woman on the spectrum, and she was in a panic, and she said, "Dr. Powell, I just had this panic attack that you're going to move away." And that was really eerie that she I ended up moving away. And so that once again made me go, wow, there's that, because that's more than just I know how someone thinks. There was absolutely no way that she could have been tapping into something that I was transmitting.
I'm thinking of Dr. Who's the original doctor that was super good with hypnosis and made it basically mainstream? He would look at somebody when they would come in, and he would know right away if they were, you know, cheating on their spouse, or if they were they just lost their job, or they had a certain illness or something. And it wasn't really psychic. He was just able to tell because of certain mannerisms that were so subtle that you that myself would probably not pick up on, but he could, just because of the way that his brain was put together. So I almost wonder if this ESP, or this psychic phenomenon, as the way that it's described in the mainstream, and not just the mainstream, but the way most people feel it is, there's more to it than that. It's not really magic or psychic abilities. It's just the fact that you're picking up on it because there's these little mannerisms that your subconscious mind has the opportunity to understand.
Well, and I one of the reasons why I think that I'm in a really good position for doing this kind of research is that not only is it because of my training and background, but it has to do with the fact that people who know me personally, they kind of compare me to Sherlock Holmes in certain ways, because I've worked with so many people from all walks of life, and I can read people extremely well. And so I know a lot about people very, very quickly. And so it's kind of like the magicians who also, a lot of people who are parapsychologists have a background in magic because they're able to, that they have the training to enable them to discern sleight of hand kind of tricks. So those of us who are, you know, who are members of the Parapsychological Association, we're not all necessarily believers in these phenomena, but we've seen enough that we think that they absolutely should be pursued, that they actually are important for us to understand. But I've also seen with these autistic children things that I cannot explain by what you just described. They that's not what's happening with these children. And so I think that there's more going on than what you described, because that's I'm very much on the alert for that kind of just really, you know, a lot of people call it cold reading, or you know, just this ability to you just have so much information about people and what tends to be common and what tends to go with what, and it's just a highly evolved pattern recognition skill.
Okay. I was thinking of Milton Erickson, by the way. So very famous hypnotherapist, and I've studied a lot of his work. It's just remarkable what he was able to do, and to take that genre to the next level. It's amazing. So, you know, for people that want to expand their mind and harness these abilities to create this ESP type, how would you do it? Are there certain skills and techniques that you know about or write about that somebody could use to further themselves?
Well, that hasn't been my focus in terms of teaching people how to develop these skills, but I know a lot about one of the things that I did was I started looking into how is it that what is the state of consciousness? What is the brain? Every state of consciousness has an associated brain activity. And, you know, so when we go through the different stages of sleep, for example, they're recognizable by their EEGs. They look different from one another. And similarly, when people go in for imaging studies, you know, at functional MRIs, I mean, now they've got it to the point where you can see that the person activates their brain differently if they're imagining something versus if they're recalling something. And, you know, so that could be used as a, you know, more sophisticated lie detector, for example, because you unless you've rehearsed a lie, you would have to use your imagination to come up with it rather than, so you're activating your brain differently. So one of the things that I started thinking about was that, you know, what is it that these people who are professional psychics, what is it that their brain is doing? And one of the things that, and they have good days and they have bad days. And so I'm very interested in finding out what that looks like. But the problem is that the brain imaging technology, other than just using EEGs, that a lot of the brain imaging technology exposes people to very strong magnetic fields. And because of the fact that our brains are electromagnetic organs, these fields are very powerful. A lot of people with psychic abilities have not wanted to subject themselves to the imaging. So it's not like we have a lot of imaging data on them. And so I've pieced together what imaging data I could find on people like Ingo Swann, who worked with the Stanford Research Institute as a remote viewer. But so what we know about his brain, and then also what do we know about the brains of people who experience these phenomena to a much more common or much more frequent extent than other people. And one of the things that has been said repeatedly, consistently in the literature is that even people who are normally not psychic, who wouldn't think of themselves that way, they're too analytical, their brain's going all the time, they're not someone who creates that sort of open space, that openness, which you need a certain amount of turning off your responses to all of the stimuli we're bombarded with all of the time, or even just the thoughts that we generate all the time. You've got to be able to turn that off and allow the reception of something that is an unknown, you know. And so getting into that state of consciousness is not the typical MO that most people in this hurry, 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 you know, rat race kind of world that we live in, you know, when we're marching into modern times, you know, at this fast pace, you know, it's very different from indigenous cultures in which there's this opening, this time, you know, that's allowed for these experiences. And so for a lot of people, these insights occur when they are in their dreaming sleep. A lot of us don't remember our dreams, but there's been account after account after account of people who had they had an experience of their dreaming. They wake up from the dream, and their twin sister was, you know, killed or injured in an accident hundreds of thousands of miles away. You know, there are all of these accounts that are like that show that there is some kind of unseen connection between people and that we can tap into, and that but that the state that we have to be in to tap into it is more of a receptive state rather than this sort of most of us are in this not really truly in a receptive state. And so a lot of us during dreaming sleep, though, we're asleep. We've shut off that part of our brain. You actually see areas of the brain become quieter that are more active in people that are awake. And, you know, but these areas become quieter in people who also meditate and other conditions that seem to be conducive to that receptivity. And then when I looked at people who have this history of being psychic, I looked at their brain activity, I saw that it was very similar to dreaming sleep. So it's kind of like when they're in, there's some similarities there. And so when they're able to be in a conscious state while they're still awake, although some psychics do their work in trance states, but they're able to somehow be in this consciousness state that is, it's kind of like this in-between state, and the state that allows them to have access to their subconscious and not just their conscious mind.
So there's going to be skeptics that would say, well, why can't we just go out and guess why can't one of them go out and guess the lottery numbers if they're psychic and they have the ability to do that? What would you say to them?
What I'd say is that most people have not prepared themselves to have these abilities. So one of the things that's happened with me, as I said, is that I sit as a psychotherapist across from a lot of people in a receptive state, not knowing what they're going to say next, having an intuition oftentimes about where they might be going or what they're going to say next. And then I'm have been in a position where I can ask them questions about what they were thinking or whatever and get feedback. And so it's like one psychic I know says that it's like a muscle that you learn to exercise. It's so being in that state of empathy, being in that state of listening, being in that state of receptivity with a person over time is what has enabled me to enabled there to be this bond that, and then also the information. So what two things that are really important for telepathy, and as I say, I'm still doing research to come up with, you know, proof for it, you know, definitive proof for it. But the things that research over and over again say is that that there's an important factor that you have an emotional bond with the other person you're trying to have that telepathic connection with, number one. And number two, it's more likely that you're going to have a transmission of information if it does have meaning to you. And so somebody just, to me, it kind of diminishes or trivializes what the process is, because it's one that you, just like meditators, if you look at the do brain imaging of somebody who's in their first year of learning meditation, and you look at the imaging studies of these monks that have been meditating for 40 years, you're not talking about the same brain activity at all. You're not talking about the same state of consciousness.
It's fascinating. I've seen video footage of these monks in Tibet that were, I don't know, about 18,000 feet up at the coldest night of the year, and they all went outside of their temple and basically sat down in the snow in their robes, and they were able to adjust the heat of their body to where not only was the snow melting underneath them, but around them. And they were totally fine and calm, and then you could see the people that were video recording it, and they were in these huge coats and gloves and scarves, and they were shaking while they were video recording them, and they could barely stand it. It's just amazing to watch that. And I've seen video footage of the Chinese in these very cold rooms sit down, and it was just freezing cold when they all got together. And then by the time they were halfway through, they were taking off their shirts and sweat and, like, you know, using it like you dip a rag into a bucket of water and then get rid of the water by squeezing it out. It's just fascinating.
Yes. And that's the thing. I mean, you know, it's like to put it, you know, bring it back to something that's like, you know, a reference point that put, you know, that anchors that in the more mundane world. The field of biofeedback is one which I, as a psychiatrist, am aware of, where you'd have somebody, let's say they have an anxiety disorder, and people who have an anxiety disorder frequently have cold hands because the adrenaline shunts the blood away from the periphery, i.e. their hands. And so one of the things you do in biofeedback is that you want the person to learn how to relax. And it's sort of like, you know, well, how do I relax? And the person needs feedback to know when they're actually, their body is in a relaxed state. And so what we used to do is we'd put a thermometer on their finger. And we just say, you know, look at that thermometer, and I want you to bring that thermometer up to, you know, the red mark. And people would learn how to, you know, people who'd think, oh, come on, you know, I don't know that I could do that. People can, it's remarkable how quickly people can learn to do that just by focusing on that. And they don't really know what they're doing in the sense of being able to articulate, like, you know, oh, I, you know, they might say, oh, I just focused on thinking that my hands were warm. But the reality is that that mind-body connection, that ability to shift things like that. And so these people that you're describing, I mean, they've mastered their unconscious mind to a greater degree, because they, you know, it's like we've got all of these dials, you know, buttons inside that regulate temperature and regulate all kinds of other things that most of us have been so focused on external devices that we use to control our world that we haven't really paid attention to trying to access internal controls. You know, a lot of people they think these things are not possible, and I think that it's really important for us as human beings to be aware of you know, that we actually can master a lot of things that we tend to think, oh, well, I couldn't do that. But then we love that story of the person who, you know, oh my God, you know, he was caught between, you know, a rock and a hard place, literally, and he saws off his own, you know, limb so that he
right. know, guy was awesome.
Right, you know, and it's just like, wow, you know, do you think that guy thought he could do that before he had to do it? Well, you know, it's just, you know, the abilities that we have as human beings, I think that we get so beaten down in terms of what we think we're capable of. And so that's one of those reasons why I think that this kind of information is important to get out there and to have it spoken about in a way that's not like a put down, not a, you know, like, a, oh my God, you know, I bet you believe in fairies too, you know, or, you know, that kind of reaction. It's like, no, hey, I'm talking about something that, you know, if this stuff is true, wouldn't you want to know that? Wouldn't you want to cultivate that?
Well, it just blows my mind how some of the most supposed intelligent people in the world or some of the most highly educated and rewarded in society are so close-minded to other possibilities. And the more I think about it, it's probably because they've spent so much time in certain fields that they feel like such an expert that if you bring something else up that kind of might knock them off their pedestal or make that theory of theirs not a reality, it's like they just can't accept it. So they have to fight what they've learned their whole, you know, their whole career.
Yeah. And to me, that's really, really sad. But I do see that. I consider that, you know, there's a lot of ego that goes into, unfortunately, into it. And to me, I'm about the science. I'm not about the ego. I mean, if, you know, if somebody, what came up with as a theory, if there was someone else who, you know, had information and had some, you know, insight into the whole thing and was, you know, and showed me that and made me see it very differently, I wouldn't be offended. I wouldn't, you know, I'd be appreciative, or I'd, you know, I'd be like, oh, okay, you know, well, you know, I was, you know, I was going up that path, but, you know, let's do a, you know, mid-flight correction and, you know, look this other way. So, but that's not how because a lot of people, they get so invested in the, you know, their reputation, their, you know, just all that comes with having established a name for yourself, you know, you know, in a particular field. And then, you know, on top of that, getting funding, you know, you're asked as a young scientist, if you have new ideas that would subvert the current paradigm, I mean, you're asking for funding from the very people whose paradigm you want to subvert, and you're not very likely to get it when they themselves are kind of in the same boat of still looking for funding themselves, and they're going to fund the people who think like they do. So there's all of these things that I see that get in the way of scientific progress when it comes to our understanding of who we are as human beings.
Yeah, it's certainly a fascinating time that we live in. And with the more we get connected, the more that I learn, it seems like the less I really know. I thought I had all the answers at one point in my life, but it just gets more amazing every single day. Mm-hmm. Another thing, too, that I wanted to ask you is you've been doing, you know, psychiatry work now for years, right? I mean, it's something that's been, and you've talked to a lot of people, different levels of, I guess you could say, reality in their own mind. You've probably talked to people that are considered pretty crazy and everything in between as far as a legal standpoint and the terms, I guess. But could you tell us about some of the more fascinating experiences that you've had, if you can share those with us, about what has really made you look at things differently?
You mean like what have I personally witnessed that has made me think, oh, this isn't what I thought it was before, that kind of thing?
Well, let me give you an example. Maybe we could get into something a little specific. Have you ever dealt with anybody that claims to have been part of some type of MK Ultra programming?
I have not had anybody who has claimed that. However, I have had someone who claims that she's being gang stalked.
And do you believe her?
You know, I do actually believe that. I mean, I do. I knew her before this started happening, and I, you know, and the people who are behind gang stalking, you know, it varies. You know, there's all kinds of people that are, you know, it's a phenomena that has many different types of people that are doing it for different reasons, and to me, it's one of those things where people who already carry a psychiatric diagnosis, this is what she claims, that she's been targeted. You know, that's part of why she's been targeted, and you know, and if you think about it, I mean, if there were people out there trying to test out methods that where you could do something, you know, to them, it's not unprecedented in our society, or you know, it's certainly not, you know, I mean, during World War II, there were a lot of experiments that were done on people, you know, by the Nazis, and so, you know, there's been a lot of experiments that have been done by medical institutions on medical students. There have been lots of stuff. There have been studies that have been done on poor blacks. There's been studies that have been done on people who are in the military, who were not informed, you know, all in the name of science, but secret science. And that, you know, that sort of dark side of science and technology, unfortunately, will exist as long as we keep, you know, it secret, you know, and allow it to remain secret. So I know those kinds of things exist. I'm not naive to think that they don't, but in terms of, you know, my own personal experience of I think that there are things that are happening to people, and we don't have sufficient resources for these people to go places who make these claims for it to all get sorted out, that they're safe places. So I'm a big advocate for people who have been labeled with mental illness, and I think that, you know, just because someone's been given a psychiatric label does not mean that everything they report is a sign of mental illness. I mean, you know, and so sometimes people do have hallucinations and they do have some of these experiences, but they also, that doesn't mean that then just discredit everything they have to say. It doesn't work that way.
Well, certainly the physical eyes only see 0.01% of the electromagnetic light spectrum, and then your brain filters out approximately 50% of that. So there's stuff out there that our eyes can't see most of the time, and maybe there are certain people that at specific times are able to tap into a different part of consciousness and see something that maybe is there somewhere. Who knows? You know, that there's certainly a lot of speculation on that, and I don't claim to have the answers, but one of the reasons I brought up the MK Ultra thing with you, Diane, was because I had an interview last night with somebody that reached out to me a few weeks ago, and I ended up talking to three people, and one of them claimed to have been a part of an MK Ultra program from like the age of four. And some of the key words that he said, if you'd either have to really study the MK Ultra program, be a really good actor and know when to say certain things because of the dialect that he was using. But then some of the stuff that he was saying was just so far out there. I'm thinking he's either making this up, he's legit, he's making it up, and he's got some legit things. But some of the stuff that he said that they did to him correlates to things you can do research on your own about some of the MK Ultra stuff that was done. It's just horrific and it's absolutely horrible. And if that happened to somebody, I can certainly see how it would make them crazy. I mean, you know, how would it not make you crazy, some of the stuff that was done? So I'm wondering if I should, I'm really debating putting this podcast out on the channel because I don't want to discredit anything. So I'm just trying to think of a good way to find out if he's actually genuine or not. Could you give me some advice on how to be able to pick up on truths and such? Because I talk to people on all different fields and spectrums, and it's good to have a good discernment for them.
I mean, in terms of specifically about the MK, Ultra program, I wouldn't know, because it's hard for me to I have all of this experience that informs my pattern recognition, and I haven't really worked with people who have come in claiming, specifically be part of that program. And so I don't know that I can really, I can't really say that's my level of expertise. But I think that one of the things that is interesting is that I look over time, I look for, when somebody's telling me stories, I look for whether it's consistent, whether or not it's coherent, whether or not it fits with, what's already been described, whether or not the person's whether or not there's some sense behind it, usually I think that there's some kind of thinking about is there a motive. I try to understand the bigger picture, so oftentimes you have to get the person to talk beyond just the specifics of, what's happening to them. The same thing if you had somebody who says, I was abducted by a spaceship yesterday. I would do kind of what you did in your interview in terms of looking at, what did you experience? How does that compare with other people who've claimed to be abducted by spaceships? Does it all hold together? If I talk to you at another time, does your story, are you holding the same, do the details stay the same? Do the details change? So there's what's the person's facial expression like? People tend to, if they're telling the truth, they don't tend to, have to think as much about it. Like recalling doesn't cause somebody to do what I just did just now, which is there was a break in the fluency of my speech because I had to think about what I was going to say next, which if I'm talking about things that I've experienced or I know like the back of my hand, then I don't do that. So there's all these different little cues like that, talking to people who know the person, who've known the person. Because I've found that people who have unusual experiences, if the experiences are valid, that you'll usually find, people that have known them that can vouch for them. That's been my experience, but it makes it much more difficult if they're living kind of in isolation from everybody.
Have you ever talked to somebody that claims to have been abducted or contacted by extraterrestrials?
Yes. Uh-huh. Yeah.
See, I've talked to many that have claimed to have contact, and that's one of the things here at the Leak Project is we're a big part of the disclosure movement, and I do my best to be as neutral as possible. I just ask the questions and, let the guests go from there. So, which I think is important sometimes to get the truth out, whether it's, it's their truth is really what it comes down to, because everybody has their own truth in some ways. Obviously we're all part of the same spectrum in the matrix, but things are certain, correlations, et cetera. But regardless, so they always seem to have some type of really incredible psychic abilities. People that have multiple experiences or contacts with what they claim to be extraterrestrial seem to be very psychic, and that phenomenon seems to kind of hover around them. Have you noticed the same thing?
Yeah, that's one of the things that I'd say is very frequently reported, is that the who not the people who've just seen a spaceship, but the people who've actually claimed that they've been taken on board, had an interaction with other life forms, the people who make those claims they also report that it's almost like they had, you know, some kind of upload or a down, you know, a download or a, you know, a,
right.
A chip put in, you know, that just all of a sudden now they have all this information they didn't have before. Those are very frequently part of the whole scenario. And one person that I know who is a professional psychic, who is someone who she knew John Mack quite well, lived with him for several months, and she's one of the people who he wrote about in his book, Abduction, the first book. And I've met her, and there have been times when she's really been amazing in terms of she'll just contact me out of the blue with some image, some thought that she had that is just right on. It's just like so interesting. So with her, and she's the person that who's had those experiences that I know the best. I've seen these phenomena where she'll contact me. And like, I'll give you a specific example. I hadn't heard from her for a while, and she contacted me out of the blue saying that she had this image of Danny Sheehan and of John Mack. And so she's someone who also reports that she's a medium, and that John Mack and Elizabeth Targ and various people come to visit her and continue conversations with her because she knew them. So she contacted me out of the blue, not knowing what I was up to, saying, John Mack, you know, Mack, and he was pointing in. And also the stairway, and at the same time I had this strong intuition to contact you, and it was really strange because it was like you were there was this other piece in which you were driving through a forest that was snow covered, and I'm somebody who normally flies to conferences, and I live in Southern Oregon, and I normally fly during the winter months to any kind of conference that's in California, because the mountain pass between here and California can be very dangerous in the wintertime, and I don't really have the kind of I have a sports car. It's not the kind of vehicle you want to drive.
Right.
You know, sliding mountain path, especially with trucks that come through. I mean, it's just diesel, you know, these semis, you know, and they get jackknifed, you know. So, this was the message she gave me, and I thought that was really interesting. And I wrote her back and I said, well, that's interesting. I'm actually leaving tomorrow to go to this, event in Northern California, and Danny Sheehan's going to be there, and I'm going to see him. And so I get in my car the next morning early to drive to this event so that I'd be there in time for it. And I drove through the pass, and the snow, and the pass is like a forest. You have all of these trees. They were all snow covered. The snow came right up to the freeway, and it was so beautiful. And normally, if the snow came all the way up to the freeway, I'm talking about like it was literally everything was covered except the freeway. And the thing, what it was, is that I was there at just the right time, that there was just enough traffic, just enough sun, that they hadn't declared that you needed to have chains and all of that stuff and put up the warning. And so I actually was able to drive through it in the snow, through this forest, mountain pass. It was absolutely stunningly gorgeous, and then went to meet with Danny. So I thought that was interesting that she that she saw that and contacted me about that, because that was not, as I said, I normally would have flown, and that was the first time in all the years I've lived here that I've actually driven there during the snow.
I remember driving through the Colorado mountains one year, and it was just, you couldn't even see sometimes because the snow was so extreme. So yeah, driving in a sports car, not a good idea for sure. You know, I'll tell you, your book is just the ESP Enigma, the scientific case for psychic phenomena. I've got to get me the hardcover of that thing, because there's just so much information in there. And for folks that are listening, check out Diane's website, DianeHennessyPowell.com. That's Diane, HennessyPowell.com. Now, let me ask you also, you put together a couple other books, Seriously Strange and Beyond Forgiveness. Tell us a little bit about those.
Well, so Seriously Strange actually is the result of a collaboration when, so this was back several years ago, this German foundation was, they were creating a series of academic books, and they wanted to create an academic book about ESP, and so they invited the authors that they wanted to participate in this sort of it was a several day private retreat in which each of us gave a presentation, and we watched all kinds of interesting films and had discussions about it. And so, like, Dean Radin was there and Ed May was there, and so a lot of people who are highly knowledgeable. Jeff Krippal was there, and he's from Rice University, and he's actually a scholar about his background actually is in religious studies, and he is a scholar who's written about a lot of things, including superheroes. And so he's the editor. He and an Indian man who's been studying Kuhar, who's been studying these phenomenon, you know, for consciousness and these kind of abilities that in the Vedic sciences would be called siddhis, you know, these special abilities that we call ESP in the Western world. And so it was this amazing opportunity to sort of brainstorm with other people. And then that book is a result, and each of us created a chapter for it. And it's an academic press, an academic book. And then the other book that you mentioned, Beyond Forgiveness, that was put together by Phil Cousineau. And Phil Cousineau is an author who's written dozens of books. He's a filmmaker. He has his own, basically he's an interviewer for New Dimensions, which is one of the public to show on public radio on NPR, and he also does things for PBS. And so he had invited me to participate. He and Rich Meyer, who had come up with this idea, had asked me to participate in another group project. And it really is very different from the other work that I do, but it's also very much a large part of what I do. That is that I'm an expert on post-traumatic stress disorder. I've worked with the worst post-traumatic stress disorder there is on the planet. I've worked internationally. When I was in San Diego, I helped to create and grow a program for people who were survivors of torture and genocide. So I worked with people who were the Lost Boys of Sudan. People from Rwanda and Burundi, where they were having that massive genocide in which, you know, people were getting killed.
What's that like?
Doing that kind of work with people that have been that traumatized.
Yeah.
Well, that's just it. It's really, on the one hand, it can be because I'm very strongly, a lot of people hear me talk, they think they hear my intellectual side, but I'm also a very compassionate, empathic person. And so, it was actually extremely on the one hand, it takes a lot from you, but at the same time, it was very rewarding work, because a lot of these people who, similar to the autistic children that I work with, a lot of these people are thought of by society as broken, damaged, and irreparable, and they're not. So just like with some of these autistic children who have difficulty communicating, and I'm involved with helping them learn how to communicate and become more independent, with people who have been severely traumatized, I've helped them to, go from, looking, some of them looked like the walking dead, go from that to actually finding a purpose in life and really feeling whole again. And so that book, Beyond Forgiveness, Reflections on Atonement, was put together because Rich Meyer realized that he knew several people, public speakers that he admired, whose work has been that of helping to heal these major wounds that occur that create this divisiveness between us, where you have, so for example, Rabbi Michael Lerner is one of the contributors to the book, and he is somebody who's trying to help bring peace in the Middle East and get us to look at the whole issue of, the Palestinian question and in a different way, in a way that, would bring about some kind of resolution rather than this very polarized view. Another contributor is somebody whose son was killed by a gang member. His son was working as a college student, as a pizza delivery person, and he was shot by this gang member for the pizza. It was one of those things where they called him to, ordered a pizza to a fake address. The guy shows up with the pizza and he gets killed for the pizza. And the man whose son this was, he actually met the grandfather, who was the one who was raising the gang member who killed his son. He met him, and the two of them formed this bond, and they have gone around to schools around the country, and they've prevented tens of thousands of people from joining gangs by telling their story. Another person who's a contributor to the book is grandson of Gandhi's. And so I think you're starting to see some of the message of this is how, after you've had someone do an atrocity, to you, in front of you, and there's a lot of that going on in this world. A lot of us are getting vicariously traumatized just by the news. And so how do you, when it's real and it's there, how do you find hope again? How do you find, how do you retrieve your own, how do you find your own soul? So that's something that I work also with people, helping them to get motivated and inspired again. So it's very rewarding work, and it's, and it's also a very important part of what I do. So thank you for asking about that.
Absolutely. And you brought up the news. One other question I wanted to ask you was, if you look at the movies today versus 30 years ago, the TV shows, pretty much the whole entertainment industry, it's completely different from what I've seen. And I studied communications in school, where you learned about the subliminal programming of the media. It's called programming for a reason. And if you can kind of see the underlining tones of these movies and such, then that's okay. But I feel that it's really force feeding the entire archetype of, people that watch these films. It's kind of leading them into this very dark path. And when I say dark, it just, you look at the movies of yesterday, like, Ferris Bueller's Day Off, National Lampoon's Vacation. And now you watch some of these TV shows out now, like Lucifer. And if you watch Childhood's End, which was on the Arthur C. Clarke novel, based upon that, it's a TV series now. It's a great series, but it's all really portrayed towards the light and the dark. And I'm not a religious person at all, but I can certainly see this push of, worship this dark entity. You know, all these movie stars come out, say they sold their soul to the devil for fame and fortune. Roseanne Barr comes out on a late night talk show and says that she had to remortgage her soul because she wasn't very famous anymore. I don't know if you saw that, but whether they're serious or not, it's just the persona that it leaves to the people. And you've got little kids growing up seeing this kind of stuff, and I feel like it's not really giving them a chance. I feel like people should have the opportunity to make their own decision, and you as a psychiatrist have probably seen the studies that they have done where if somebody is actually watching something happen, if somebody watches somebody get in a car accident and get killed, he's actually living that in a sense because he's seen it happen. The part of his brain that's activated is the same part of the brain that's activated in the person that's actually a part of that experience. So if you look at the special effects and the conditioning and the different symbols and such and the music at certain times and the tones, etc., that is portrayed in the media today, it seems like the MK Ultra of yesterday, where it was only done on certain people, is now kind of more of a global phenomenon, and they can do it in the media and Hollywood, etc. What is your thoughts on that?
Well, I think that's an excellent question because I don't even own a TV. Okay, I
good
really,
for you.
And I didn't, thank you. And I didn't grow up with TV. And I look at what TV does, and I really have a lot of concerns about how it is shaping our society in ways that are at multiple levels. I mean, so there's the there's always been a discussion, or when I say always, I mean, I've certainly seen a discussion for many, many years in the professional literature about the, you know, the whole issue of imitation. You know, you see something on TV, is somebody likely to imitate it? So, you know, there's that level of that level of thing going on. There's this quality of creating the opposite kind of consciousness from the kind of consciousness that I want to cultivate for myself, or have cultivated for myself, and would want those around me to cultivate for themselves, because I believe in having an active, inquiring, aware mind that's paying attention to what's going on around me and increasing my awareness. And TV is all about distraction and planning things into your unconscious mind with an agenda. There's always an agenda, and even if the agenda is a good agenda, there's always an agenda. And so and TV itself, this is a really important thing that I it always struck me as very interesting that TV itself, if someone sits in front of a TV and watches it, they actually burn fewer calories than if they sit on the sofa and do nothing. And so there's something about the way that TV is having an effect on people's brains, such that it puts them into an even more, I think that the fact that they seek it out, there's already a certain passivity of, oh, I want to turn off my brain, I just want to receive now. And then the TV itself also feeds into that. And so what you have is more and more people who they're utterly convinced they're thinking for themselves, and yet they're really not, they're not aware of the degree to which they're being influenced. And emotions are used to manipulate us. Scientists have known for a long time that one way in which you can manipulate people is by activating their fear and then presenting them with the solution. And combining those two together is very powerful, because people go, once they've had that fear activated, they're like, oh gosh, you mean you have a solution for that? And that's a lot of the stuff that's on TV now is activating people's fear, and people even say that they bond with one another through this sort of shared fear, because they're becoming so numb to a lot of other things that they want that peak experience, even if that peak experience is fear, because they still see it as, well, that's imaginary. But the reality, you know, when we're talking about these shows, and so, but the reality is that even though it's imaginary, it's still entraining their whole mind-body system into a certain fear-react kind of way of being in the world, which is the opposite of the tune out the distractions and check in, go deep inside, try to become more in tune with your own inner process in your own body. It's the opposite of that.
Well, and it also seems that the culture today, there's no identity. You know, people are lost within themselves, not only with the pandemic of autism and these neurological problems. It's just that there's this disassociation with society. Everybody's plugged in, yet everybody's not associated with each other. You'll see five people sitting down in a room. They're all looking at their phones, playing video games, or looking something up on the internet, checking out how big Kim Kardashian's butt is, whatever. You know, that's the exciting thing today. And that was a joke, but it just seems like there's really this, you know.
It's too true to be a joke.
Truth and humor. Truth. It's unfortunate. But, you know, you look at the 50s and the 60s and 70s, and the way that every 10 years there's like this different genre. But it just seems like it's this digression, not progression. And with all the technology and advancements and opportunities that we have now just at our fingertips, maybe it's become too easy to live life. So the majority of people have become lazy in a sense. You know, we used to have to pillage for our food and shelter and fire and to stay warm, etc. We were fighting the elements. Now it's just so easy to have access to stuff. Many people can live off the system easier than actually going out and getting a job. So I hope that our future generations, like my children and my children's children, will have the opportunity to live in a society where it's not idiocracy, but a new renaissance of sorts. So do you think that that's even going to be a possibility with the way that we're going?
You know, it's really fascinating to watch how society evolves, because I think that we have to, you know, we tend to think of time as an arrow, when I'm not convinced it is. I mean, certainly Einstein, you know, and other physicists have questioned that. But anyway, and we also have this tendency to think of trends as always kind of continuing in the same direction. But, you know, there's also this tendency for certain things to then react and swing back, you know. And so it's interesting, because I think that we're living in a time period now where it's almost like people are just, they're pushing the limits. They're trying to see how, you know, you look at North Korea threatening nuclear war. I mean, we're living at a time period where everybody is like, they're seeing what, you know, you have high school students that are sending naked pictures of themselves to one another, you know, and, you know, you're having all of these things that are pushing the limits to see what's going to happen. So it's a very, very critical time period that we're living in. And the question is, how do we respond to this? And I find it really interesting that the people who have money, people who are in areas where there's this, where they're interested in personal growth, self-growth, like, for example, like in Silicon Valley, you have a lot of these people that are into the tech world, and they're paying lots of money to attend mindfulness workshops, where basically they're paying money to not be allowed to be plugged into any technology, just to experience what it's like to be, you know, in more of a retreat where you don't have that there, where you're, you know, either a silent retreat or you're communicating with others. And it's like they're paying a lot of money for that. And similarly, there are people who, you know, they've grown up in a city. They don't feel like they've got any survival skills. They're paying money to go and be, you know, learn how to, you know, build a fire and, you know, live in the cold and make do. And, you know,
right.
And so people are paying money to experience things that we got for free before we had electricity.
Well said. Now you've got to pay $20 to go out into the woods and, you know, put two rocks together and try and start a fire. That's awesome.
Right. Right. So I think that things, what happens is that once people, like, it's kind of like, think about it as like the adolescence of society. You know, what does an adolescent do? They push the limits with their parents. You know, they do stupid stuff.
Right. That's definitely true. We're kind of in the time of, I guess you could say, polarities, total opposites, going to the extremes on each side of the spectrum.
That's right. And see, when you see polarities like that, what you're seeing, it really relates to the underlying chaos and confusion, because people feel more of a need to nail it as one thing or another. It's an intolerance of uncertainty and ambiguity. And so we have these it's almost like funnels, you know, that basically, because we live in a society where I can watch the news that gives me the message that I already believe, I can, you know, Google questions that already kind of will give me the answer I'm looking for by how I word the question.
Right.
I can connect with other people who think like I do, even if my family and people who live in the same town as I don't. So then, you know, the constraints, the social constraints that keep a cap on this stuff, they've been removed. And so we're living in what, you know, is, unless you can keep their perspective about it and your sense of humor about it and keep clear about, you know, from your own inner guidance about, you know, where do I want to go with this? You know, what do I want to do? You know, what's my response to this going to be? You know, rather than just rolling over and into a sense of helplessness, to think about, well, what can I do? You know, so those are all survival skills at this time that are necessary. We're being reminded constantly by, you know, the system that things are broken. And so it's really it's an opportunity for people to show up and show us who you are.
Absolutely. And one last question I'd like to ask you before we close out tonight is the connection with psychotropic drugs and a lot of these mass shootings. It seems to me that with the research that I've done, almost every one of these school shootings or mass shootings has been done by somebody that was on a specific psychotropic drug. And I'm wondering what your opinion is on those.
You know, I take each one of those reports with a grain of salt, because on the one hand, there are millions and millions. I mean, the psychotropic drugs are a multi-billion-dollar industry, you know, so there are far more people out there who are on psychotropic drugs not committing atrocities than there are the ones who do. And then there's this question of, I think that there's a combination of things going on here, because there is literature that we've recently found out had been suppressed by the pharmaceutical companies, that they knew that teenagers were more likely to have a side effect of feeling suicidal on certain antidepressants than you know, was really reported to us, you know, and so now they're coming out and saying, you know, that there've been black box warnings against, you know, prescribing certain meds for people under the age of 18, and, you know, and that's information that when people first proposed that maybe someone could become more suicidal on an antidepressant, that was all poo-pooed. But at the same time, you have to also look at, you know, why are they being put on the psychotropic medication in the first place? And so it's, you know, it's a mixed bag. But I think that one of the important messages is that our psychiatric system, and this is one of the reasons why I've been moving back into more and more public speaking and less clinical practice, is because psychiatry has become, when I trained, it was a holistic way of approaching someone. You approach them as a, you knew about their physiology, that's why you become a doctor first. So you knew about the fact that you can have medical conditions that mimic psychiatric conditions. And so you want to make sure it's not that. You also know about the person's inner psychology and how that affects behavior. You also know about the different types of psychiatric illnesses. You also know about social effects on people. You basically look at a person as an entire human being, what their context is. A belief is not delusional if they're in a peer group that all hold that same belief. No matter how crazy it is, it has to be idiosyncratic to that person, you know. And so, because people can be influenced to believe all kinds of things just from peer pressure. So there's a whole bunch that goes into a psychiatrist's evaluation of someone. But what's happened is that insurance companies have decreased the amount of money that they will pay us to see patients. And so the time that most psychiatrists spend with patients is very brief. The pharmaceutical companies have come out with all of these medications that get advertised quite heavily on TV. And doctors get pressured to go the route of prescribing medication rather than spending time with the person to figure out what's going on here. And so I think a lot of it is it's really more of a representative of a breakdown of the psychiatric profession from one in which we were allowed to really be more holistic, and it's become more one of, you know, just viewing pills as the solution. And in many of these cases, it's not about pills. You know, we've got to look at, you know, is this kid being bullied? You know, is this kid being shunned? Is this kid being, you know, if somebody's abused, you know, I mean, you abuse a dog from the get-go, you know, that dog's going to bite somebody someday.
Right. Absolutely. And you don't have a TV, so you haven't seen these commercials, but there's so many out now, these pharmaceutical commercials that'll say, oh, do you have depression and are already on antidepressants, but you're still depressed? Well, you should try this pill because it might make you less depressed, but it actually might make you want to kill yourself. So you just need to be careful. It's just unbelievable. And people are like, oh, maybe I should get it because the music sounds good. And look at the person on the TV. That person looks so much happier now. They're talking about that medication. I mean, at first they all look gloomy. They weren't happy, but now they're on their pills and they're happy. It's just unbelievable, the sheep-like mindset that many people have. And there's people at the higher levels that know how to take advantage of it. So, and that's what they do. It's very fascinating times that we live in, Diane. And it sure has been an honor to have you on the show. I certainly enjoyed spending time with you. You're very eloquent in the way that you put things together. And it was just great talking with you.
Thank you. You're a wonderful interviewer. I appreciate your thoughtfulness in the way that you ask your questions and the way that you are able to then pick up the ball and then take it to the next level.
Oh, well, thank you very much. And I would also like to let our listeners know, please check out Diane's work at DianeHennesseyPowell.com. Once again, that's DianeHennesseyPowell.com, the ESP Enigma, Seriously Strange, and Beyond Forgiveness. Thanks, everybody, for joining us. This is Rex Bear. Have a fantastic afternoon.